wait till we're on.
Yeah, you do have to sort of.
There it is. We're on.
All right, we're going to start with the applications, the hearings for today.
Do the minutes?
Yeah, let's do minutes first. That's a good idea.
I mean, we accept the minutes as given.
Anybody else have any changes, please?
Second.
Again, very nicely done.
Yep. Any other discussion on the minutes?
Nope.
Have a motion in the second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, motion, minutes approved. Get to tonight's docket. Number one, Christine Circle. Any questions?
Kind of straightforward.
Yep. Two, Plank Road. Mine, I don't have any questions on that.
My one thought that I had is, I know you include the two other storage buildings in there. What was the justification for saying that size was okay? So, I mean, they're about half the size of the, I think, the one that we're looking at tonight. Was there any justification back then?
Well, because they were half the size.
Okay.
Yeah.
You went out there, right, to the property? All the equipment in the back and everything?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a lot of, whew.
It's a big space.
We're on,
So we had some people interested in getting started. I won't say who, but they were at the opposite end of the table.
They got a green sweater.
Hey, how are you, Smiley? Jeez.
I just told them, I haven't been here in a while, but I can still tell that.
You can still start trouble, is what he meant.
Very good. I'm sure you guys were very efficient in my absence. That's all right. I don't have any problem with that. Go ahead, Mike.
The minutes have been approved, just.
Good, okay. I didn't have any issues with them.
Okay.
Can add his name in.
So, yeah, I guess any particular reason why, Harold, you included the two, number two, you included the two prior.
Just to show that they were.
They're practically right next door.
Fairly recent, and they're practically next door. I think one of them may have.
I think one of them is in the back. Next door, yeah.
Okay.
Well, I think there's a property out front that separates them, but.
I noticed on one of them, today's applicant actually gave a letter of support, though. There was a reference in one of the approval resolutions to the letter.
Oh, okay.
They supported that?
Well, this is.
Tonight's applicant.
Somebody else's.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yep.
All right. So three.
Yep, three straightforward.
Okay. Four.
Canceled, right?
Withdrawn.
Four, withdrawn.
Four is withdrawn. Everybody here know that?
No, we haven't announced it.
Is anybody here for the?
Dog grooming one.
Dog grooming.
And dog grooming one has been withdrawn.
Yeah.
Yeah, we tried to reach out.
So you're welcome to stay, of course, but if you were here for that one, you should know that.
Okay. And number five? Special permit for outside storage. You're certainly familiar with this parcel.
Boy, I know.
Got enough applications there.
You know, and I think I asked, is this guy going to rent the front of the building, Harold? That little spot over there?
That, the location that, from my understanding, that we previously approved, that coffee shop. Remember, about a year and a half, 2 years ago, we approved a coffee shop over there?
Uh-huh.
They started doing some work, never finished up, and.
So it's that little parcel, the second thing in, yeah, little teeny one.
Little tent space, maybe 35 foot across, I think.
Okay.
And they're going to take cans in there and then store them out back?
I believe it's more the cans, but, I mean, it's obviously.
Cans and bottles, right?
Yeah.
Or is it other things?
I suppose it's a good question to ask, yeah.
All right, anything else on that? Number six. That's the Smallwood Nursing. That seems pretty straightforward.
Yep.
And you may have not received the approval from 1968, I think it was. But if you read closely, I believe they are making representation that they had been in business there from 20 years earlier.
Okay.
So it's, it may be one of the oldest continuing businesses in town.
Which one's this, Pete?
Small World, Miss Rita's old place on Brockville.
We got a lot of phone calls about that property. People were concerned that it was changing into something else when they saw it was conditional use permit, so they were relieved to hear that it was from the same in a lot of cases.
Yeah.
People were concerned because it's sort of a, you know, similar.
Didn't they used to have a TV program, Miss Rita?
Yeah, she did.
She was on.
Her name before, do you remember?
Uh,
I don't know. Rita. I was kind of respectful. I just called her Miss Rita.
Martin is her name now, but her previous married name was...
It's our turn to think.
It's in the paperwork someplace, I think. But I think she did some Romper Room stuff.
Yeah, she was on TV with Romper Room.
That's what it was, Romper.
You used to watch it, Mike.
I did, faithfully. All right. So let's move to table. Number one is continued, right?
Probably still tabled. The planning board tabled it.
Yeah, they haven't received anything. They haven't received anything.
All right, which brings us to number two. Creek Street.
Okay, the last time I learned that this was unlisted and no action was required. This is not a cold listing, but it's similar in nature and compatible with the daycare and nursery schools that are listed. We tabled it to give the applicant time to research and review local and state laws for preschools and decide what type of sign she wanted. This does meet all 10-4 requirements. It's not detrimental to health, safety, or the welfare of the neighborhood. She did check with the New York State Department of Education about regulations and also the Child Care Council for nursery schools. And she found that she does not need to be registered. She actually knew this, but it was reconfirmed and confirmed to us. She does not need to follow any regulations of less than 3 hours a day. And there were no specific fire regulations other than the basis that they use for small businesses. We allowed a movable, or I'd like to allow, we agreed it was okay, a movable sandwich board sign. And this, I guess, is what she wants and what her mother wants. And this is to be put out only during school hours each day and taken in. Her classes are to be no longer than 2.5 hours, no more than 12 children, no more than 2 sessions, 9 to 11:30 and 12:30 to 3. Children are to be supervised at all times, inside and outside. We have a copy of the temporary fencing that she would like to use if and when children are outside. We talked about the driveway, whether or not she needed exit or enter signs. And actually, the driveway is wide enough for 2 cars to pass, so I don't think we really need to need 2 signs, one saying enter and one saying exit. And I think that if people are dropping off their kids every day, they'll know, you know, what way they come in and what way the other ones could go out or whatever. She's not allowed to prepare food, and the parents bring snacks and water. Nothing's to be sold there, and the front steps are to be improved as stated. And she's not adding any additional lighting. So with all this, I move that we grant the yoga preschool permit.
Second.
Go ahead, Andrew.
Any further discussion? Oh, sorry, Mike. That was very thorough.
Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome.
And the fencing, are you going to leave that up permanently, or are you going to put it up and then take it down?
Yeah, I think we'll probably be putting it up and taking it down, depending on.
Yeah, no problem. I think that's the best idea, but it's your yoga school so, and her yard. So, okay, that's all I have.
All right, motion to approve in a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Very good. The other one's going to remain indefinitely tabled. Okay. Yeah, you can stick around or you can go. Yeah, good luck to you. Very responsive on the issues that we tabled. So good work. Good luck to you. So we got about 15 minutes. So I could have been even 15 minutes later. It still would have been time. All right, we'll stay adjourned for about 15 minutes and start at 7 o'clock. Thank you. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to a regularly scheduled meeting of the Penfield Zoning Board of Appeals. Tonight's meeting is going to take place in two parts. The first part will be our public hearings. We'll ask the applicant to come up to the podium and give us name and address, and then explain to the board why the relief requested should be granted. Once the applicant is done with the presentation, board members will likely have some questions, and then we'll ask anyone in the audience that cares to come up and speak about the application. Do the same thing. Come up. Give us name and address, and then make any appropriate comments about the application. Sometimes we have questions for witnesses as well.
After the public hearings are adjourned, we'll take a brief recess, and we'll reconvene in the back of the room to deliberate on tonight's applications and then to take care of any unfinished business the board may have. Members of the public are welcome at both sessions, although the deliberations are times generally reserved for conversation amongst board members with staff, and sometimes with counsel. Our agenda tonight, by the way, has been reduced by one item. The Creek Street dog grooming application has been withdrawn. So leaving us, I think, five items, which is a average or medium length agenda. As I said, you're free to stay. You don't have to. If you want to leave or need to leave, you can call Allison or Harold tomorrow to find out what action, if any, the board took on a particular item. Every month we point out that it's the town's practice and policy to notify neighbors that live near the property, which is a subject of an application, that the application is going to be heard by this board. Town does that by sending out postcards to neighbors that live within a certain distance, putting the agenda on the internet, posting the agenda here, and also making the applicant post signs out in the front. And the town does that so that its citizens are more fully informed of their right to come in and comment about this, which we think is a pretty important aspect of what we do, and we think it works well. So that being said, I'd ask everyone to rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. And Harold, may we have the first application, please?
Is there anybody here for that dog evening?
Well, is there anyone here on that dog application?
Oh, see?
Okay.
Application number one, Irwin Allman, 17 Christine Circle, Penfield, New York, 14526, requests an area variance from Article 3-3-37-A of the code to allow a garage and porch addition at 17 Christine Circle. This is property. The property is owned by Ellison and Irwin Allman and is zoned R-1-20. This is SBL number 109.07-1-4. This is application number 15Z-0024.
Hi, Irwin Allman, 17 Christine Circle, and I'm here just to ask for a tiny variance for a garage extension that I would like to build.
Okay, any questions?
Yeah, Irwin, approximately how much of your porch is in violation, like a foot, 2 foot?
Yeah, good question. This drawing here, hopefully you can see it on camera, you know, shows that. What I did is I measured the, I took the property map and overlaid it on a drawing, and I just, saw where the property line intersects the proposed addition, and it just cuts this little orange corner here. I verified it by just going out with a, regular old, long tape measure and measured 60 feet from the curb, because I understand my property line is 10 feet from the curb, so I went and verified it and, staked it out. And, the property map matched the measurements they actually made. So it's just this little corner, and actually that's the open porch area. So it's, it's less than 3 feet.
Yeah, just to have people...
In that one little orange corner right there.
Right, and just to have people see it on camera, can you point to that little corner on your drawings there?
Right there.
No, so, on your drawings.
Oh, I'm sorry. So it'll be this little bit here, right, like the staircase.
So it's not the garage, it's not the structure itself, it's just a little of the porch.
Yeah, I guess it would probably go to about here, so it would just be, touching the garage, and without survey equipment,
Right.
It's hard to say exactly.
And it does look, I'm a little far away because I'm old. Is there two different drawings up there to you?
Yes, this is what it is right now.
Oh, okay, all right.
And this just shows.
And that's what it's going to be afterwards.
It will be. Okay. So, yeah, I tried to do it so it would, be relatively simple, be cost effective. And all I'm doing is just taking the existing roof line and just, pulling it out.
Right.
And that just gives me a bigger garage.
And a
bigger
porch.
And it gives me a really nice little porch area here, which is nice kind of more or less southern-facing exposure, which will be nice at certain times of the year to enjoy the outdoors a little more.
Right, and it looks by your picture, you're going to have the same color siding done on the whole house, so it won't be two different colors, it'll be all one.
Oh, yeah, that's right. We're going to, I'm torn a little bit because we're eventually going to side the house, but we feel like we got another paint job or two, so I've done cedar shingles before, so I'm gonna do that for now.
Okay.
I figure about $500 in materials for cedar.
And are you going to contract this out, or are you going to do it yourself?
A little bit of both. I mean, I guess I'd say I'm the general contractor. You know, I'm hiring the, you know, the masonry work done.
Okay.
And I'll be doing the framing with, you know, friends, myself. And then when we're done with this, we're going to be redoing the roof. So, you know,
yeah.
So I'm not going to be doing the roofing. We're going to do a full tear off and put on a whole new roof.
Okay, that was my other question.
Yeah.
Are you going to do the roof? Because, like you said, sometimes you can see an old and new roof, but if you're doing it temporarily or whatever, you're tearing off the whole thing, it'll all be one.
Yeah, our roof is on borrowed time, so, you know, I'd like to get this done and then, you know, do the roof.
Right, and you're not, by coming out with it, you're not making any environmental changes, like if it rains, the way water flows, or?
No, I don't think so, because, you know, the rain that would go on the driveway will now be collected in our gutter and go down to the same water collection, I don't know what you call the, you know, the thing in the road, I don't want to call it the sewer, but whatever you call it.
Yeah.
Sanitary.
Storm sewer.
Storm sewer, thank you.
Okay, and last but not least, there's a little tree in the corner. You're going to have to remove that tree, right?
Yeah.
Where the porch is going to be?
Yes, we're in the process of doing that right now. It's,
okay.
Yeah, it's about that big around.
Yeah, it's not a fully mature tree, but it's a good-sized tree, so it'll cost you a little bit of money.
Yeah.
Okay, that's all I have.
Any other questions from the board? Anyone in the audience care to speak about this application? Come on up.
Can I go over here?
Yeah.
Sure.
First of all, I don't know exactly how far out the garage. Erwin came and talked to my husband. I was not home.
Can we have your name and address?
Sue Verone, 18 Christine Circle. I live directly across the street.
Okay.
Erwin came and talked to my husband about this, and he didn't leave information as far as how far out toward the road it's going to be coming. How far out is it?
16 feet.
16 feet.
16 additional feet.
Yes.
Okay, so it's...
Can I speak?
Sure. Yeah. Well, yeah, why don't you come up so they can catch you on the mic as well.
So from the curb to that post here will be almost 60 feet before we get to the 60-foot diameter circle.
That's,
you know, the
part
big,
I don't, yeah, that's the part I don't understand.
There's still a big buffer.
Yeah,
and this is
where does the 60 feet go?
Okay, Dan, you want to do it or you want me to explain?
Go ahead.
Okay, it's, you have to be 60 foot, it must be in that, a lot of times it's 50, but there's a 10 foot, Harold, is there a 10 foot?
No, the required setback is 50 foot.
Okay.
Right.
But the 10 foot, he's setting it back 60 because is there some
not
kind
from,
of
not necessarily
easement?
Curb,
that,
though.
No, let me say again. I believe it's curb, and then it's 10 feet to my property line.
Right.
And then 50 feet.
Okay, I got. And that's where the 60 foot. Okay, now I can explain it to her. It'll be.
It ends there at that point, or
no,
that's where it starts.
This right here is the closest thing.
Yeah.
Like right here.
Uh huh.
And you still have almost 60 feet till I get to the curb.
From the end of the garage to the curb.
Yeah.
Okay.
See, this is the existing house, and the little gray thing is the new area that I'm adding.
All right.
It's just that little thing.
This is actually, are you going to be blacktopping all this also?
Yes.
Well, this is in part of the project, but yeah, when we're done with the garage and we're getting the, you know, new cement.
Is there issues with that? I mean, are the regulations in regards to blacktopping, how much of your lawn you can blacktop? You can blacktop the whole lawn if you want, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
You can actually.
Let me just explain what that 60 foot is.
Mm-hmm.
All houses have to be set back 50 foot from the road, okay? And if you want to set your house closer to the road than 50 foot,
right,
you have to get a variance.
Okay.
And that's what he's here for. Now, the variance he's asking for is only about 2 foot, and it's only in the...
I see that little orange there.
Yes, right. And that's because... You guys live on a curb.
Yeah, right.
So your house is farther away on one side, it's closer on a different part of the curb.
Okay.
So that's why he has to come in and get the 2 foot variance. If he didn't put that like that, he could have put the addition on by just getting permits without coming in front of this board. So that's why he had to come in front of the board.
Okay, so his, the end of his property is going to be much different than everybody else on the circle.
Well, there are some houses that are closer to the 50-foot mark. Most houses are probably 70 foot, 75 foot away. Am I right, Erwin?
Why don't you come on up again?
Yeah.
Stay up here with me.
Yeah, I wasn't sure how this works.
The microphone is there so that everybody, they can capture it for
television,
for the record and for television.
Even if you look, you just go to, you know, Google Maps and look, even after we build the addition, the house to the north of us will still be closer to the road. I mean, the difference is it's on the straight part of the street and it's not on that circle. Correct. So as far as, you know, the only thing that we're talking, I think, is separation, you know, face to face across the circle. And we, you know, our houses are still far apart. You know, the other ones that are on the straight part are still closer.
I'm not questioning that. I'm questioning what, from my living room, I'm going to have to look at, and it's going to look like all garage.
No, I don't think the garage will be any larger than it was, what she's looking at,
it's
right?
It's not
the
going
door.
Any wider?
No. So it's just coming out.
So this is the existing, mm-hmm. and this roof, right? And then this is just pulling this thing right out. Just like take the front of it, pull it right out. You know, the door is staying here.
Yeah.
And this is like an additional 16 feet.
This here is additional 16?
Right. This
and
way.
This doesn't change at all?
That's correct. Yeah, this face, you know, right
okay.
here is the same right here.
All right, so when that comes out like that, if you're at your front door, can you see down the road?
No.
Or could somebody come down the road and see you? No, right?
No, just like I can't either now.
No, you can't either now. That's right. Right. So my question was, are you going to be able to put the boat in the garage? Is that the purpose of the garage? No?
The boat. I don't think the boat is really part of this, is it?
I don't know.
Well, she's entitled to ask the question. I mean, you can answer it if you want, but you know, we might ask the question.
The boat isn't going
we
in
might...
the garage, right?
The current boat, it would probably not fit. And I did do some measurements of it, but I think it would be tight. It would be tight the wide way.
Okay.
Will it be next to the garage, or will it be in front like it is right now?
It'll
will the garage come out and block
be
part of that?
Back as far as I can put it.
Okay. Yeah, because I have to look at that too.
The legally parked boat.
I know, but you don't have to look at it in your living room. Because mm-hmm. from your living room looking out, mm-hmm. you're not going to see. Will you see the garage? No. Will you see the boat? No. Who will see the garage and the boat? Me. That's all I'm here to say.
Okay, thank you.
Fair enough. Anyone else in the audience care to speak about this? No? Okay. All right. Thank you very much. Next application, please.
Application number 2, Mark Zareski, 1356 Plank Road, New York, 14580. Request an area variance from Article 3-3-35-D-3 of the code to allow a larger storage building at 1356 Plank Road. The property is owned by Mark Zareski and is zoned RA-2. This is SBL number 095.03-1-18. This is application number 15Z-0026.
I'm Mark Zareski. I reside at 1356 Plank Road, and I'm seeking a variance in the ordinance to erect a building larger than the zoning code permits. I currently have 2.5, almost 3 acres there. And the idea behind putting up the building is to, my primary is to put all the equipment in that I have to take care of the property. As you see from the pictures, that all my trees are well over 100 feet tall, have a couple of bucket trucks that I use to take care of them.
You all set?
I'm set.
Any questions from the board?
Yeah, exactly how big is this building going to be that you're proposing?
My request was 60 by 40.
And how high?
The walls would be 14 foot high.
And at its highest point, how high?
I hadn't figured that one out, but.
Approximately? Give me an approximation.
Probably 16 to 17 foot.
And what would it be constructed out of?
It would be a pole barn, which is wood construction with steel exterior.
Okay. Steel roof as well?
Yes.
And color? What color?
I was looking for red, or what is that?
The barn red, I mean?
The barn red. Yeah.
So it's not going to match the structure?
The house?
Yeah.
No.
Okay. And where is it going to be located on the property?
The house, it's actually parallel to the house a little bit. We have a walkway that's a covered walkway that goes here to the existing two-car garage. And it'd be set back from the garage probably about 20 feet.
Are you going to have to remove any trees to put this in?
No. That's the object, is I like my trees. And
okay, and the entrance going to face the road?
Correct.
Okay. Is there going to be any more pavement put in to?
No, typically not. I have a side driveway here that is just dirt, and we typically, my neighbor and myself, use it. My neighbors don't have any complaint on either side of me.
Is that driveway going to lead directly into the entrance to this?
No. Not really. It just kind of runs right along the, this driveway runs right along here, the property line. And so my neighbor John, he uses it to access his building. And
there's currently a couple of vehicles in the back of that. Are those yours or your neighbors? Along that road towards the rear?
Well, two of them are sons.
Are your sons?
Yeah.
Are those going to be included in this building, or are you?
No, they're my one son just bought a house on Northrop. That goes to that one, and the other one goes back with it.
So they're going to be removed? Is that
correct?
What you're telling me?
Yep.
Okay. So where are the vehicles that you're going to be storing there now?
They're back on that road there.
Okay.
Yep. I'm surprised you didn't see them.
There was a few there. So so those are going in.
So that's correct.
Are you going to store anything else there other than vehicles?
Well, I grew up working with my hands, and then use that as a place to have a hobby and work on cars, things like that.
And is this going to be, are you going to charge for this, or are you?
No.
So you're not running a business out of it?
No.
And you won't be?
No.
But you are going to use it for repairs of what?
Well, cars? I have a large family.
Okay.
Not just immediate family, but a church family. And I help a lot of different folks with their cars, try and mentor them with the right things to do.
Would you say that this would result in an increase of noise on the property?
No.
Because we did get a letter from a neighbor concerned about the noise that's existing on the property, and fearful that if this gets permitted, that's going to increase. Could you address that?
I could.
Would
I think
you?
She's referring to my sons, who no longer live there. And that was, I mean, they stop by from time to time, and they'll still make noise. Those are kids. But no, none of my boys live with me anymore.
Is there any other buildings this big in that area?
Well, I know there's two pole barns behind me. I don't.
Size-wise in relation to yours?
The one newest one is equivalent to the size of mine.
On a similar size lot, or you don't know?
I don't know his lot size.
Is there going to be any exterior lighting?
No.
Okay.
Don't have, no need for it.
Okay. And how did you determine the size that you needed? I mean, it's almost 10 times what the code permits, which is significant.
Well, I was just looking at the size of the bucket trucks. And they're typically 25 to 30 feet long, because they have a 60-foot boom, and want to be able to get the both of them indoors.
Okay.
And I have tractors along with, you know, it's not just the bucket trucks.
And just for the record, would you describe the buffering and the general nature of the property? I mean, it's
heavily wooded, okay. Both sides.
Well, I've been on the property, but I just so for the public hearing, I just wanted you to address that. And will it be visible from the road?
Not much.
I don't think so.
Because of the trees.
Okay.
Yeah.
And it's going to be sitting behind your covered walkway garage?
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. That's all I have.
I got a couple. Yeah.
Hold on. She's only.
Oh, I apologize. I didn't
okay.
know she
you
wanted
both
you go right ahead.
Thank you. I just have one question. Why do you have two bucket trucks? Just for your own property.
Well, sometimes you run across a deal you can't pass up. And in the line of work I'm in, that's how it happened. So my son does cut trees for a business. It's not related to where I live or work. He works for Arbor Tree. And so he helps me do what I got to do on the property.
Since there seems to be a question about all the equipment and so forth that you do have on your property, is it absolutely essential that you have the two bucket trucks there? Does your son usually use one of them? Is that kind of why you?
No. The intention originally was for him to take one and go off on his own to do his own work, but this stage of the game, he's not sure whether he wants to tackle that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, yeah, you have three trailers, right?
Yeah.
Okay, you have a green truck, which is your son's truck?
No, that's mine.
Okay, that one's yours. You have a what is it, a black car way in the back?
That's my son's.
Okay, and you have, is it a dump truck?
No, that's one of the, that's a, we would call it a chip truck.
Okay, yeah, chipper. I was going to say another one's
I have a chipper.
A chipper, right?
Yeah.
And then two boom trucks?
Yeah.
Okay, now,
no,
are
no,
you saying?
Just two trucks. One is a.
Yeah, there's three trucks back there, whatever they are.
No, there's two trucks.
Two trucks.
Yeah.
My lion eyes. Okay. Are you saying then that all three of those trailers and all the equipment will now go in this barn?
That's what I'd like to happen.
Okay. Yeah. Then if that's the case, do you need the tent that's back there?
No. That's
okay.
My
so
intention
that,
is to get rid of that tent.
Okay. Then
that tent
will be removed.
That's correct.
And all the equipment will be out of sight.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
Gotcha. That's it.
What are you going to have for the floor? Is there going to be a concrete pad?
That's correct.
Okay. What is the typical lifespan of a pole barn like this, if you know?
30 years.
Okay. All right. And I was going to ask, I just want to make sure, everything that's outside today or at this present time, let's say, your plan is that all goes indoors?
Correct.
All right. So, and do you have any plans to add any equipment anytime soon?
The intention is to downsize eventually. But
all right. Well, the reason I'm asking is if anybody thinks that the equipment outside is unsightly, which some people I'm sure would feel that way, if you're saying that one of the reasons you're asking for this very large variance, I mean, it's, as Mike's pointed out, it's tenfold what the statute allows.
Mm-hmm.
But you're asking for it because you're saying everything that's on the outside is now going to go in and stay in, except,
correct,
of course, when it's being used.
Right.
That's a, well, some might think, a good reason to ask for what you're asking for. Okay.
I have one question.
Sure.
Is there any way you could have a smaller pole barn and still fit this, all these things in?
Be kind of tough to get them in there and walk around.
Yeah.
And that's the idea, is to be able to do what we have to fix.
So you've measured this all out?
Yeah.
Okay.
Will the
do you know if the peak of the pole barn is going to be higher than the peak of your existing roof, so you'd see it from the road if you looked over
I
the
think,
top?
I think it's going to be, the peak of that should be identical to the garage right now.
Okay, so it would basically blend in, and you wouldn't see it towering over the back
Correct.
If you looked from the road. Okay.
Yep.
That's all I have.
Okay, anybody in the audience care to speak about this application? Come on up.
His father was pastor of our church. Mark has promised when he retires to help the Boy Scouts in maintaining equipment, so I think this is a great idea. It gives me a place to bring stuff to get fixed. And if he has a problem with storage, we have the Scouts own properties that they could store equipment on. If the town had a problem that they wanted to get rid of. Oh, Ed Linscoop.
I know you.
Yeah, okay. I thought I'd been here enough so everybody knew.
Well, I would agree.
I apologize. 40 Willow Pond Way. I think it'd be a great asset to the town. I don't think he's going to be working forever, and I plan to put him to work when he has a vast amount of knowledge and equipment, and that's one of our shortcomings with the Scouts. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Anyone else care to speak about it? Come on up.
Yeah, you can sit down right there if you don't.
Sure.
I'm Sue Unkles. I live at 1340 Plank Road, two houses down. I'm really opposed to this building going up. I've had problems with Mark and before with noise. I've lived at the property 9 years now. I grew up at the property though, so I moved back when my folks died 9 years ago. It's already been discussed here that there's a lot of construction equipment already there. And now it's also been discussed that there's going to be vehicle repairs going on here. So that was my main concern because I've had problems with noise before. I'm concerned about now more noise from dirt bikes being stored. They have loud motorcycles and dirt bikes. And now there's going to be car repair going on. And so I'm concerned about the noise. I can't really see where the building is going to be because it's way back in his woods. John's shed has kind of taken care of that, blocked my view. So what it looks like isn't really going to matter to me. But because I've had noise issues over the years that I've been there, I'm really opposed to it.
What does the building tend to, if it's done indoors, tend to lessen the noise? I mean, you can do car repairs outside, too.
I guess I don't get your point.
Well, if he's saying that the repairs are going to take place inside this pole barn, wouldn't that make less noise than if they were being done outside the building?
Initial repairs, maybe, but then take the car out, try it out, run it up and down the driveway, take the dirt bike in, fix it, run it up and down the driveway, take the motorcycle out, fix it, run it up and down the driveway. It's a long road back in there, and part of the problems before were dirt bikes. Now his sons don't live there anymore, but you know they're old. They got to be at least in their 20s, maybe more.
20.
So
they're 27 and 30
okay,
now.
Okay, so you know, in lieu of past problems, I haven't had any problems lately. But I can see where this is going. Cars in and out all the time. Dirt bike repair, motorcycle repair. I just am opposed to it.
I certainly understand what you're saying, but unless I'm wrong, all of those things that you're describing, he can do now. He can bring a buddy's a motorcycle over and repair the motorcycle on his property, as long as he's not charging, as long as it's not a business. And I'm not saying that it justifies a 2,400 square foot building. That's a whole nother issue. But your concerns, which are totally legitimate, I'm not sure that they would be addressed by anything that's before us or not. If there's a noise ordinance, if there's an issue there, you should always feel free to report that. But the point that Mike is trying to make, and it's a fair point to make in response to your concerns, is if he agrees, if we grant this variance to perform any repairs indoors only, that may help some of the noise. Testing the bikes, You're right, you know, that's, but that's not going to go away whether, if he's going to do it, whether or not he has a pole barn.
We're not talking about his own personal stuff now. Somebody just got up and said, oh, I'm from the Boy Scouts, and now they can fix all our cars. I'm like, okay, great. So I can see where, like I said, I can see where it's going.
Yeah.
And he's a, you know, member of the, his church group, apparently, and so he's going to be fixing all these millions of cars there. And, you know, I'm not concerned about... Huh?
I don't have that much time.
It's not the issue of the only issue here for me is the noise.
Right.
And because I've had problems in the past, and I've had to go over a few times regarding noise from not only vehicles but other kinds of noise, and it's.
Well, why don't we bring you up and let's ask you some questions about
sure.
that. Is what she's saying a fair statement about noise in the past?
Absolutely.
Okay, so what's to stop that from happening in the future, with or without the pole barn, by the way, other than your good discretion and wanting to be a good neighbor?
Right. Well, the noise shouldn't change at all, because I do fix cars there now. My boys and people from church and you name it, John next door, Jeff on the other side of me, you know, I help people out doing that. And they appreciate that. And I'm sorry that we make so much noise, but the motorcycles are gone, except my own. I still have a street bike, but the dirt bikes are gone. Jason might come back from a race and stop by and say hello, but.
So the times when she was talking before about bikes being driven, were they riding on the property, or were you just testing them out?
No,
oh, so
no.
They were riding on the property.
Yes.
Which is,
I've been there 13 years now.
Yeah, sure.
And my son was a lot younger then.
Yeah. Okay. Would you agree that if you did any repairs, that they would be done indoors?
Absolutely.
If you were granted this variance?
Yes.
You know, if you need to go out and see something for better light or whatever, there's always a small exception, but the gist would be, if you're going to make repairs, do them indoors to reduce the noise level.
Yes.
Okay, Mike, go ahead.
No, it sounded like what you were saying was the noise had improved, so this was not in the immediate
past.
Lately,
yes. I haven't had any issues in quite a while, actually. But I can, like I keep saying, I can see what's coming. And because of what is being said about, you know, all the Boy Scouts are now involved, and church group is now involved, and friends and neighbors, and...
But they've always been involved. That's what I wanted to reassure you that... That's not going to change, because
cars coming and going all the time,
I just
have this picture in my mind of what it's going to turn into, and if you give him the approval to do it,
well, I want you to understand,
you know,
he has that approval
right.
already. He has that
then
right.
Why are we here?
He has the right to make the repairs on his property.
And where are you doing those now, the repairs?
In the driveway, unfortunately, and
okay.
You
so
know, with
not,
this kind of weather, it's not. Very conducive to
not in the structure, you're doing it outside.
Correct.
Well,
and
can I ask, is this it's almost like a business then, except you're not getting paid.
That's
is this allowed?
That's what makes the difference.
That's called a not-for-profit.
Between a business
well, those are hobbies and
that's you know, you're listen, your position is very understandable and very
Absolutely.
Reasonable. I want you to know that. The limitation on what he can do there is noise. Harold, are there any other things that would, you know, using certain materials, I suppose, there's, you know, you can't have any health violations or anything, environmental violations.
Yeah, you wouldn't expect anything like that.
Welding?
Right.
Well, there would be
it's
nothing to stop
cars.
Him from doing welding on his property, in an old
yeah.
property, if he's got welding equipment.
And
my guess
insurance.
Is you probably do.
I do.
Yeah. Well, I'm not even going to say he needs to have insurance. It's his own property, whether he wants to carry insurance or
burns
not.
Burns it down, it's his problem.
He may not have a mortgage, which wouldn't be compelled to carry homeowner's insurance, other than it's not a good idea. But, you know, I think some of the things he's doing for his friends, for his extended family, his extended community, whether it be the church or the scouts or anybody else, if he wants to help them out, I think generally is perceived to be is good for everybody.
Do you when you are doing repairs, is there a particular time of night that you'd be willing to agree to stop?
Oh yeah.
What time would that be?
6 o'clock.
Even on weekend, even in the summer on weekends?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. And how about starting? What would be the earliest you would start?
8 o'clock.
Okay. Are you an early riser?
No, sir, but he's not just right next to me. I mean, we've got a double lot in between me and his neighbor.
Right.
And then another lot, so if he did repairs inside a barn, I probably wouldn't hear it, although I'm retired. It means I get to sleep in now.
Yeah, well, good.
Am I correct in assuming that the repairs themselves aren't making the noise? Is it more what happens afterwards?
It's more like what has happened in the past, that I'm concerned about what's going to go on in the future. And I just don't want it turning into a repair station. Every day, cars coming in and out and noise and vroom, vroom, dirt bikes and, you know.
No, there's an ordinance against that.
Well, that doesn't mean that, you know, people don't do... You know what I'm trying to get at.
Mm-hmm.
And that's basically what it is what has happened in the past. I'm concerned about what it's going to turn into.
Okay, how about as well maybe a limit on the number of vehicles on your property that you don't own that you'd be repairing at any given time? Could you do that?
Yeah, I don't. It's not like I stack up vehicles. It's, if, okay. If there's a number of vehicles there, it's usually because it's a gathering.
No, that's fine, but I'm talking about for repairs. What's the most you've ever had there that you didn't own or your family didn't own that you agreed to repair? Two, three?
Two, maybe. Okay.
So you certainly would be agreeable to limit it to two?
Sure.
If not one?
Sure.
And I don't care about that. I care about the noise. I don't care if he has 5 million things back there. I can't see them. There's so many trees between him and me, and so many other buildings, John's house, John's shed. And the other thing I was concerned about was the construction noise. When John built his shed, he worked on that house 24/7, 365, all summer. I didn't have a minute's peace, all day, every day, all summer long. And I don't want to listen to more construction for the rest of the summer. It's another thing.
Is he going to sub it out then?
Yeah, what about your construction? How long is that going to take? Who's going to do it? Are you going to do it?
That was my intention, but.
How long do you think it would take?
Probably a couple of weeks. It's a pole barn's not as intense as what John built.
Just a structure on a pad, right?
Pretty much.
Would it be possible when you're repairing things that are noisy, like dirt bikes and motorcycles, to maybe do them at the person's home that owns it, or if it's a scout's on their property instead of at your place?
The difficult part of that is the tools required to do that. I have a lot of specialized tools.
Okay. All right. You all set? Anything else to add?
Yes, yeah.
Okay. Anybody else in the audience care to speak about this? All right, thank you. Thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
Application number 3, Peter and Lori Pincus, 44 Devonshire Drive, Penfield, New York, 14526, request an area variance from Article 3-3-37-A of the code to allow an addition at 44 Devonshire Drive. The property is owned by Peter and Lori Pincus and is zoned R-1-15. This is SPL number 139.06-2-21. This is application number 15Z-0028.
Thank you.
Peter Pincus, I'm the owner of 44 Devonshire Drive, requesting a variance for a boxed window on the front of an addition we're hoping to build.
Okay.
A few questions. Can you talk a little bit more about, you know, the design criteria in terms of was the design of the house, how it stands right now, kind of the reason you want to look towards expanding to the front and not the back?
Yeah, we have a relatively small lot. We built off the back. The house was 900 square feet. We had a child. We built a living room off of the back, and so we really don't have any more space to go there. We have a deck also that we built, but it would not be cost prohibitive to go that way, and then we would have no backyard. And so then we, of course, had a second child, and the front, in particular, this area was the only place that was suitable.
Sure. And really that, I guess, you know, that bay window, box window is really the only part that's...
Yep. It's, you know, not attached to the foundation.
Right, so it's actually the foundation's back a little bit. It's really just the window, the kind of like a bay window that sticks out there a little bit.
Yes.
Can you talk about your neighbors' houses, like let's say across the street? How close are they relative to the street? Are they fairly close compared to how you guys are?
They're very close. We have a 50-foot setback, but I don't know, the neighbors might have like a 10-foot setback.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that was...
And that's just across the street from you?
Just across the street.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. The neighbors on either side of me, of course, are 50-foot
right.
setback as well.
Right, right. And so the design criteria really keeps you to the front, and there's really no way you could put anything to the back because you have a deck back there, and there's already
mm-hmm.
pre-existing things you've established back there.
Mm-hmm.
Were there any other designs you looked at that could have possibly worked but didn't end up working?
We did at one point. Michael's the architect, and he
okay.
can talk. We've been kind of drawing things for four years now since we built the house and started expecting. And, you know, we've thought about going across the entire back. We've thought about putting a second story on. We thought about going across the entire front, all of which were cost prohibitive. And
yeah.
this, the area that we're building is off of our current bedroom. So it will allow us to turn our current bedroom into a bathroom, and we'll have our own sort of our space.
Yeah, so it's like a master suite in a sense.
Yeah, master suite.
Okay. So there's really no other ways that you found that you were able to do this. Have you seen any issues with, like, your neighbors across the street, that they're much closer to the road? Do you see any issues with, you know, or problems with that being so close?
Mm-mm.
No. Okay. That's all really I have.
I got one.
Okay.
Okay, when I was there, I believe I met your wife and
yes.
adorable little daughter. And she said something about you want a basement, a full basement under
mm-hmm.
this?
The daughter or the wife?
That little daughter?
The daughter was adorable.
Well, yeah. She is. She's very sick.
She's like my great-grandchild. She's about that age. Anyway, she wanted a full basement, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And did you check into where the sewer comes in? Because
yes.
I think that's going to be one of the major problems you're going to run into, right? It'll be exposed in your basement. Okay.
Yeah, the contractor knows about that, and we would kind of work.
Okay, so you brought that all in, you know, into play, and also
yeah.
electric, right? Because I'm sure it
yep.
probably runs close to there, too. So, okay, just warning you a little bit about...
Yeah, he said, this could be a problem, and he's hoping because of the slopes. That
yeah,
that
it has to pitch towards the street at least a quarter of an inch per foot. So wherever it is, hate to say, that's where it is,
mm-hmm.
you know? So if it comes down, you may have... kind of a headbanger, you know, in your
mm-hmm.
in your basement. You could box it out and do whatever you want, but be aware of what the depth of the sewer is there,
yeah,
you know, in perspective to your basement. Okay,
yeah, we've looked closely at that, but unfortunately a part of it is just getting
it.
Dirty.
Yeah, okay, all right. That's all I had. I just wanted to pre-warn. So
you're
like
hearing that from a union plumber.
Yeah. Okay.
So
I'd like to put into the record that you only encroach on the setback by 1.4 feet.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, on that point, I'm looking at the one one map. Just want to make sure, because we've had issues with box windows before, where the measurement is supposed to start. Didn't we have one time when they measured from the foundation and they're supposed to measure from the...
Well, a surveyor will measure this cantilever.
Yeah.
They won't necessarily measure from an eave or an overhang, but they will measure this cantilever.
Just want to make sure that... We have the proper number for the variance.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Mike Trevanowski. I'm the architect on the job. And the numbers that you're looking at there are taken from a survey that was done back of 2011.
Okay.
And basically, the dimensions that I took off from the front setback line to the house was to the framing, the rough framing of that box-out bay. So in all reality, I know we have 1'3" on there, but we would like the variance to possibly be for the full a 2 foot.
Okay.
So that way we do have some slop in there that just in case, you know, all of a sudden we're building it out and, you know, we don't, as construction kind of goes along, we don't want to end up in a situation where all of a sudden, you know, we ask for 1.3 and we're at 1.4.
Right. Well, that's why I raised it, so that's good.
Right. So the variance would actually be for the full 2 feet, so we'd be at the 48-foot mark is where we're really looking to get to.
Any other questions from the board? Anybody in the audience care to speak about this? All right. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Application number 5, Zachary Romano, 9.5 Main Street, Fairport, New York, 14450. Requests a special permit for outside storage display under Article 4-4-24 to allow a storage trailer at 1183 Bay Road. The property is owned by the Cleveland Mary Group, LLC, and is zoned LB. This is SBL number 093.11-1-44. This is application number 15Z-0025.
Hello, my name is Zach Romano, and I reside at 9.5 North Main Street, Fairport, New York. And I'm looking to put a trailer in for outside storage at 1183 Bay Road. I'm going to put some pictures up. And the storage unit will be used for a bottle and can redemption center. The unit I'm looking at is a little too small for my needs. Not the actual unit, but the space I'd be renting. Right now, I'm currently in Fairport. I own a business, a bottle and can redemption center. It's about 1,600 square feet. The place I'm about to look at is about 1,450 square feet. So this trailer would give me a little bit more than 200 extra square feet to use. And it'd be used strictly just for cans, as you guys were wondering earlier.
Yeah. Okay, so at the business, your customers are going to come in to the storefront, dump their bottles in and be counted, that sort of thing?
Correct, yep.
And then when you get, you're going to store some in there, and then when you get, when you start running out of room, you're going to bring them to the trailer? Or?
Pretty much, yeah. Okay. We get a pickup every 1 or 2 weeks, but legally it has to be every 2 weeks, so it's not like anything's going to be sitting or stinking up the place. By law, DEC rules and regulations, in 14 days, 10 business days, they have to clean us out.
The trailer?
Everything. Yes.
Everything.
The trailer, the building, whatever we have.
All right. So nothing will be there. No matter how many you have in the trailer, they're gone in 2 weeks.
1 bag or 1,000 bags.
All right.
Can.
So the trailer itself is not going to be taken off site?
Correct.
Once it's there, it's there. It's just going to be like a storage building.
True. But the reason we chose a trailer is because if it had to be, we could move it.
Sure.
If anything came up. As you can see, it'd be behind this building here, completely out of the road's view. Here's Bay Road right here. It'd be behind the karate studio. That's 1183.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Also, there's some side views here from the side parking lot, which you'd see the trailer is 28 feet by 8.5 feet wide, about 10 feet tall. And again, there it is. But by through all different north, south, east, and west, there's really no neighbors that would be offended or it'd be in their way.
Okay, so what can you point out where the view from Bay Wind?
Bay Wind is right here. We got this one right here.
Okay.
There's a little hill that it'd go up and see. This is the other building, not that one that they wouldn't even see the trailer there. The trailer's more on this side. And the other one for Bay Wind is right here. There's a big fence, I believe, I'm gonna say about a 8 to 10 foot fence. And a bunch of trees blocking it, so Bay Wind is actually from behind here.
Okay, so it's going to be pretty well hidden.
Yeah. So from the road, you have the whole karate studio, some hiding it, and then the fence and tree line.
And now the space that you would like to place this, is your landlord aware of where it's going to go, your prospective landlord?
Yes, he's very aware.
All right. What's it being used for now?
It's vacant.
Vacant, so Nobody parks there, because we've had issues with limited parking space.
Where the trailer would be?
Well, and just in that general vicinity, we want to make sure we're not creating any more part. And, you know, if you're renting the space, then you're entitled to use it.
Right.
But I just want to make sure that it's not somewhere, a place where people park now.
No, it'd actually be on some grass or gravel, I believe, is there. So it'd be out of the way. And actually, I know Tommy Givens, the landlord there, he was telling me how the hair studio next to us,
right.
She was having problems in the past with
yeah.
people driving through, and this would actually, he talked to her about this, and this would actually help limit that and probably make it all go away because it'd be in their way.
Okay.
So, but still out of her way, and she, talking to her, the karate studio, and the Clippers, which is next to us, everyone was okay with the trailer.
Good. All right. Go ahead, Mike.
Just how are the containers going to get from your storefront to the storage? Manually?
Yeah. They're all in bags.
You're just going to carry the bags out?
Yep. It's a very short distance between the two. That's generally how our facility will work. Customer brings them in, dump them out, we put in bigger bags, count them all out, and we take those to the trailer. And the trailer would only be used when the store was full. So there's going to be numerous weeks that we're not going to need to use it. Probably for the first, you know, 6 months that we won't even need it. But just a precaution, just in case.
And so, I'm sorry, Mike.
No, and the trailer's open at one end, two end?
One end. Yep.
Yeah.
Yep, just the one end.
And that'll be locked, I presume?
Yep, it'll be locked, yeah.
Okay. That's all I did.
What other options would you have if you weren't allowed to use this trailer?
We also thought the option of actually building a facility, a little shed or something, but I decided against it because A, it's not my property, so
right.
I wouldn't want to invest in something that, you know, I can't really have. B, it wouldn't have to be there if I was ever gone. So let's say we put up a shed and business doesn't succeed in a year or ever as long as the lease is, I can move the trailer to my house. You know, I couldn't move a shed.
Right.
So that'd be the other option. We've thought about doing a fence, but there already is a fence. So, like, a fence directly around the trailer, because this fence sitting back here is a little farther back, probably another 150 feet in the trailer, roughly. But it is pretty well enclosed through the natural trees and the fence and the building.
Okay. All right, and do you typically wait the full 2 weeks before you remove any bottles, or depend how many you get? Is there?
It's up to my company. I prefer right now it's every week. If it's their busy season, it could be even twice a week. It really depends up to them, but it has to be within 2 weeks.
So if somebody comes and picks them up?
Correct.
And how? What kind of vehicle is used for that?
Tractor trailer.
Okay. And is there going to be any issues getting that in there to this trailer, or?
No, it shouldn't be. The laundromat actually has a drive-through.
Right.
And there's plenty of backyard space, for lack of words. Back here, if you can see, I know it's kind of far, but this photo here is where the laundromat is, this top of the building here. So the trailer would be sitting here, and the big tractor trailer could actually pull up. There's all gravel here, right back there, out of the parking lot, out of everyone's view from the road. And the only people I would see would probably be employees or people coming out the back door.
And how long would that trailer be there, the tractor trailer be there? How long does it take?
Depends on the day, but no more than, I'd say, about 3 to 4 hours. But sometimes it's there for an hour, hour and a half.
All right. Any other board questions? Anyone in the audience care to speak about this?
May I speak from here?
Oh, how about it? Can we get a microphone over there?
There's a wireless one.
There's a wireless one right inside the desk.
Yeah, I know that, but they have to pick up. He's bringing one to you.
I just have a few questions. My name is Pauline Sherwood, and I live on Leedale Drive, first house on the left, and my backyard fence backs up more or less to that area. I took a ride over there before I came here today, and there's a big white house back there, a big white building back there. Is that involved with this?
No, that's the karate studio.
Pardon?
That's the karate studio?
No, no. Oh, I see. Thank you. And the card you sent me said 1183 Bay Road. And the other thing I want to ask is, are you taking over some of the area, some of the little stores that are in that strip mill?
No, it's a vacant store.
Oh, it's so. Right now it's a vacant store.
Correct. It was, I believe, a chiropractor.
Yes, yes.
Okay, that spot right there.
So in order for, if I bring my cans and bottles, to your place, I'd be parking out in front and using your business there?
Correct.
Yeah, business is booming.
I wonder about traffic on that situation. Now, I'm aware of where this place is now,
okay.
And I know how much parking area you have there. So, and Bay Road, certain times of the day, you just don't want to go out on it because it's really bad, from 4 to 6, really bad. So you might ask your customers not to come at that time, but they can come another time. That would be better. So you're taking over that one little area, the chiropractor?
Yes, that's where it'd be.
Okay, that's all I need to know. Thank you.
All right, anyone else in the audience? Joe, you want the mic? We'll bring it back to you. No? Okay.
No.
Just trying to keep him awake.
Yeah.
All right.
Good luck.
Yeah. All right, well, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Last application.
Set.
Yes.
Application number 6, Robert Halpin, the Halpin Firm, 4588 Route 224, Montour Falls, New York, 14865. On behalf of SHAPD LLC, requests a conditional use permit under Article 10-10-4 and Article 3-3-36-E of the code to allow the change of ownership of the Small World Nursery at 2406 Browncroft Boulevard. The property is owned by Rita P. Barton Revocable Trust and is zoned R-1-20. This is SBL number 123.06-1-19. This is application number 15Z-0027.
Anyone here on behalf of this application?
Thank you. Leland Williams, attorney with an office in Rochester, appearing on behalf of the seller, the Rita Barton Trust. Ms. Barton is present this evening. As you could see, Mr. Halpin's home office is in Montour Falls, New York, so it's a trek for him. But frankly, if there was no opposition to this application, I will just retire.
Not from here, right? You stay
right
there.
Not from here,
sir.
Thank you.
Stay right there.
Stay right there.
I'm sure she's going to have some questions.
Yeah, right.
Absolutely.
That's not necessarily opposition, though, Lee. So.
What is this building used for besides a nursery?
Nothing.
So there's only nurseries? It's just a nursery school?
Since just before World War II, this place has been used solely as a nursery.
There aren't kindergarten classes and there haven't been in there?
I don't know about classes. Ms. Barton's indicating no kindergarten classes. This has been a daycare facility.
And how large is the property?
Off the top of my head, I'm sorry, I don't have that.
Do you want to get up at the microphone,
one
please?
One of the third acres.
You want to, she wants to stay there?
Why don't you, yeah, stay right there. We can bring you a
mic.
How's that?
There's no need for her to get up.
Thank you. 1 3 acres?
1 3/4 acres.
Okay, and how large is this building? Approximately.
How many square feet are in the building?
Yeah.
Are you asking that for a reason?
Mm-hmm.
And what is it?
Because I want it for the record. We want to know how, you know, I will be asking about how many children are there and so forth. So we need to know the size of the building.
Sorry, I don't have the square footage on me. Mr. Morehouse, do you have that available?
No, I don't have that.
Okay.
I'm looking to see if I can.
There's
find
nothing
it.
Changing. You're not adding anything.
That's
you're
true.
Not detracting anything. It's the same as it was before.
Absolutely the same.
And is this is the property being bought or just the business?
Both.
Okay. And the ages of the children that are there?
Infants through preschool.
And there's no after school?
No, we don't have the room.
Okay. And how many children per day are there?
We are licensed for, how many children? 87 children, but we never have had that many. Right now we have about 50, and that's about it.
Okay. And are the children, how many rooms are there that you use for the children?
Okay, let's count.
Five.
Okay. And do you have any classes or anything for the preschool, or they just play?
If I could answer the question, it's not like going to a school. They're not learning as you do in a school. It's discovery of learning. And so there is a curriculum. My caregivers are all registered. They all have degrees in early childhood education. And I could go on, but I guess you got.
And what are the hours of operation?
7 a.m. to 6 p.m.
Okay. And what are the ingress and egress?
How do you get in the building and out of the building?
There are many.
Pardon?
There are many egress. And each classroom has to have two means of egress. So we have porches. We have doors which open out to the existing. I'm going to ask you to pardon me. I have Parkinson's disease, and it's hard for me to talk. So don't feel sorry for me.
Well, I think you're doing a wonderful job.
Thank you.
How many employees do you have?
How many now do we have?
11.
11? And how many parking spaces?
About 18.
And is everything indoors, or do you sometimes have the kids playing outdoors? Or?
Absolutely. Every time we can get them out, even with snow shoes on and their little costumes, going outside and play.
We have three playgrounds.
Yes.
Three playgrounds?
That's the other thing that we have that's very distinctive. We have a toddler playground with the size of the equipment is for them. We have another playground, which is the main one that you see when you go by the building. And we have on the side lot, we have a pavilion.
Okay. And obviously, you think this is compatible with the general area? And it must be, since it's been there before for many years?
If I can give you a 5-minute summary of what happened is, when World War II broke out, a woman who owned that property, a large piece of property, lost her husband, not to the war, but opened up a child care center so the women could go to work in the Humboldt Street place. My mother worked in a factory that made bullets. And they had child care sometimes. And it's not an old thing. The oldest child care center in the Rochester area was started right after the Civil War, where the people brought their children there, and they were trained as butlers and maids. It's got a really long, I'm a good storyteller. I'm going to stop now.
Now, this question is not for you as much as for the people who are buying it. Are they in the process of getting the proper licenses for this?
Yeah, all the licenses.
Yes, it's all
they
done.
Have them?
Yes. It's all done.
This is the last requirement towards completing the transaction of sale.
Okay. And what about food? Do you?
Oh, it's catered.
It's catered?
Yes, the Association for the Blind.
Oh, okay.
Brings it. No, we don't cook. We play. We do other things.
Okay. So the new owners will not be doing any food preparation on their own?
No.
They will continue things pretty much as you've been doing it?
Yep. It's a good plan, and they think so, too.
Okay. Do you sell anything there?
No.
Okay. And what about music? Is the music contained within the building?
Yes.
Okay. And what are they going to do about the signage?
The sign? What are you going to do about that sign that's in the playground? Just take it down, the one that says Small World?
Sure.
Yeah. Are you going to put another one there? There is.
And the size, too.
Yeah, it's not very large. It's right at the tip of the playground, so you can see it. And it says, small world, and it's a picture of a little person with a flower over his head.
Are they going to keep the same name, Small World?
Yes.
Okay. Are you associated with the buyers?
Yes. Me and my wife just bought it
recently. Whatever operations that they have been conducting so far, it will be the same. There is not going to be any changes. So we're going to run it the way it's been running so far.
Okay. You won't be changing anything, buffering or anything. You really should be answering the questions.
I wasn't aware of what exactly. This is my first time over here, so.
Okay. But you agree with everything she said, right? Okay. We'll pretend that you answered those questions.
Well, if they know the answers, they can answer as well.
The exterior lighting is going to be the, are you going to add any more exterior lighting?
No. If exterior lighting is a problem, we can get that removed.
Well, the only problem about it is we did get a letter that I take it you heard from your neighbor. She was concerned about the spotlight that shines over her property.
The spotlight, which was outside?
Mm-hmm.
If that's the case, we can get that removed.
You get it removed? Okay. And if you need light, it has to be localized on your own property?
If there's any exterior thing that has been needed, we would rather go through, process, whatever it is, get a permission. If it's okay, then we'll go ahead and do it. But other than that...
Well, since you close early before it gets dark, generally, you might not need the spotlight.
Right.
Okay. Her other concern was, and this is something that you have a right to have whatever you want, but her other concern was the color, the pink color. But you... As I say, we don't control colors, so we do control lights, but not colors. Yes,
I'd like to answer that. The color is not pink, it's peach.
She called it pink.
Well, it's not. There's nothing neon and it's about it, and it's not pink, it's peach.
How long has it been peach?
At least 40 years. How long is it peach and green?
Mm, I can see why you changed it.
Okay, is there any question you'd like to ask us about it?
I'm good from my side for now.
Any other questions from the board?
No.
Anyone in the audience care to speak about this application? No? Okay, thank you very much. I think that was our last hearing.
Yes, it was.
So the hearings will be adjourned. We'll take a brief recess and reconvene in the back.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This is unlisted and no action is required.
Second.
Further discussion on the seeker? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, nursery schools are allowed by our code. This is in harmony with the general purpose and intent of the zoning ordinance. It meets all of our 10-4 requirements. The business, even though it's going to have a new owner, is essentially going to be the same as it's been for years. Nothing really has changed. Their sign will be the same size as the sign that's already there. They have adequate parking. Essentially, there are going to be no changes except the new owner did say he would take down the spotlight, so that should make the neighbor happy.
Or maybe redirected, so at least he has outside lighting for safety reasons.
Yeah, because 6 o'clock in December and January and February is dark.
That's right. Okay, and it will be redirected, it has to be facing down, okay? And kept in your own property. So I really think that's... about all we need, so I'm going to move that we allow this conditional use to be carried on as it's been in the past.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion to approve and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Good luck.
Yeah, and can I just say something? Ms. Rita, thank you for all your years of service there, and it's been an excellent place to bring kids, and I know I've gotten a lot of comments and letters about it, so thank you for the wonderful job that you did.
Thank you.
It's as long as I've ever been married to anyone.
Good for you.
Thank you.
Yep. All right, let's go to number five, since we're going to do reverse order. Okay, number five, I'd make a motion that it's an unlisted action under seeker.
Second.
Further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'm sorry, who seconded?
I did.
Okay.
And I'm going to make a motion to approve the trailer. I think the applicant did a good job of answering a lot of the questions we had about the operation and the fact that this is a space not being used for parking when we've had some parking issues there. Is good. It's going to be well camouflaged, shall we say, by a building and then some natural elements as well. So,
I'll second that.
Okay. We have a motion to approve in a second. All those in or any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Good luck. You're welcome. Four is withdrawn.
That's me, number three, right?
Yep.
Okay, so motion to declare as type 2 action. Seeker, no further review.
All right.
I'll second
you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And then a motion to grant the 2-foot variance. So let's make sure we correct that to adjust for their bay window there. It's not a very substantial variance. Right across the street, the houses are all much, much closer to the, you know, street, I think partially due because of the side setback from the other side, but there still are much, much closer, and so I don't think it's going to be any kind of issues with that. There'll be no detriment to the neighborhood in terms of environmental impact.
For that. Second.
Further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay, number two.
Well, I'm going to move this, that this is a type 2 action. No further review required.
Second.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And I'm going to move to approve this storage building. It is significantly larger than the code allows. However, the situation with the property is such that I think it's going to have minimal visual impact with surrounding properties. If it's going to be seen at all, only a small portion of it will be seen from the road. And if we make a condition, which I'm going to move to, that all equipment and vehicles be stored out of sight that are currently on the property, I think it will improve the look of the property. Let's see what else.
Mike, just to interrupt you on one of the points that you made, the view from the road. if a, let's say a building half that size, we're going to go in the same location. Well, my thought is, a portion of that would be, so it's not so much the square footage that makes it, maybe it's a top height of it.
Yeah, more than anything. And most of it's going back, I think.
Right.
It's, you know, it's longer. Yeah. It's, the depth is more than the width, so.
What is it, a 3-acre parcel?
Yeah,
just under.
Just a little under. And it's going to go behind buildings that are already there,
right.
And there's trees.
And we had testimony from the neighbor that the visual impact is not the concern. Okay, I'm sorry.
In the tent.
No, and I think, you know, we had agreed to limit the use of the property for repairs from 8 to 6. And I want to put that in there.
Yes.
Mike, excuse me, you might want to add just not-for-profit repair and maintenance of,
yes.
Of vehicles.
No business conducted for profit on the property. And I think probably in fairness, maybe no more than 2 vehicles worked on at any one time.
Not owned by him.
Right. Off-site. Yes, that's right, outside it. Thank you. Yeah, and there's another condition that the current tent on the property be removed.
And I would also, I know we have a noise ordinance, but I would say make every reasonable effort to keep the noise to a minimum.
Yeah.
Conduct as much work inside as you can.
And I'd just like to, you said currently on the property, I would like to say that all equipment on the property take out currently.
And be stored there.
In case he gets more.
Another deal he can't refuse.
I think his wife
had a
kibosh on that one.
I'll second all that.
Okay, it is a. This is, I bet this is one of the largest variants percentage wise we've ever granted. So I feel I don't have to say it, but I want to say it. You know, do your best to address her concerns. Nobody else was here, so Okay, great. Thank you very much for
Thank
that.
Thank you.
All right, we have a motion to approve with conditions and a second. Further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Oh, any opposed?
Me.
Okay. Number one.
Okay, I'd like to make a motion that this is a type two.
Second. All right. We have a type two seeker motion. No further review needed. And a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
I'll make a motion in the beginning to approve this because it's such a small, really, variance. I mean, again, 2 foot variance on a corner of a building. It's just because he lives on a circle. That, you know, the site from across the street would not be affected even if we didn't grant this and he cut that corner off. So it's kind of irrelevant of the sight line. You're going to see the exact same front of the building as you see now. So I took that into consideration, but I think the preponderance of it overwhelmed it. So, and that's my motion to approve.
Okay, motion to approve and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? No. Okay. Very good. So, anything else? We have the one that's just continued table.
Forever and ever.
We still have another week.
Yeah, how many are
there? I wanted to put in another application for
something, but I didn't get a chance to talk to him about what.
Remember I
said I think that road? Oh, yeah, yeah. Is it a year passed already?
No, no, it's not that.
The eye chart?
No, no, it's not the eye chart. They need more square footage. So they want to move 5 feet out the front, 4 feet out the front.
Of the building itself.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, so sorry to interrupt you, but we will adjourn the meeting until our next is July 21.
Hey, take care. Okay. Say. Take care. Nice meeting you. Be well.